All right. So we have now set the stage introducing these locally convex spaces. And in this section, I want to discuss something which is called Bastiani calculus. This is a calculus which was, I think, originally introduced in René Bastiani's PhD thesis to solve some problems back in the, I think, 60s, if I'm not mistaken. And this will be our setting of calculus in these locally convex spaces. The reason why we need a new definition for how we want to differentiate mappings in locally convex spaces is basically because the usual definition of what it means to be differentiable is built on top of a concept which is the operator norm, right? So when you recall, you have this usual way of, so you define mapping to be differentiable between, say, Rn and Rm if there is a linear mapping which approximates it, and then you basically say, okay, the first derivative is then a mapping which takes points and maps them into a space of linear mappings, and we want probably that this is continuous. And so to define continuity with respect to going into this space of linear mappings, you say, well, we use the operator norm to define continuity. However, for locally convex spaces, there's no analog to the operator norm on spaces of linear mappings between two locally convex spaces. And it turns out that this is a huge problem. So this is the main obstacle of why you cannot just generalize the usual definition of calculus to the setting, and why we need a new definition. Okay, and let's just have a look at what the definition is. It's a fairly simple definition, and then we'll later compare the calculus we obtain in this Bastiani setting with other forms of calculus, on one hand with the one you know already from the Banach setting, and then on the other hand with another concept of calculus on infinite dimensional spaces, which is very popular, so you'll find it a lot in the literature, however, which on the outset looks completely different from what we are going to do now. And the idea of Bastiani calculus is we want to take directional derivatives of mappings. So the setting is as follows. So we take locally convex space and an open set and a mapping on this open set. And then we say, well, we define first the directional derivative in a direction h. So h is now a vector from our vector space, and x is the base point and where we set this whole thing. And if it exists, we define the limit of this differential quotient. So it's basically, except that we have now have infinitely many directions, it's the same definition as a directional derivative on finite dimensional spaces. So there's nothing strange happening here, and we use the notation I will be using mostly for this is this small d x semicolon with h. So the semicolon is a little bit non-standard. What most people use here is a comma, but later on we will encounter mappings which have several arguments and are differentiated several times, for example. And so I will always use the semicolon to signify, so the first component we have here, all the components before the semicolons are the components which are associated to the base point where we take the differential, whereas everything which comes after the semicolon is the direction in which we differentiate. Right? I mean, you can also use this notation with a capital D H here to make the distinction between base point X and the direction in which you differentiate. At least for notational conveniences, often, at least I like the notation here with the semicolon a little bit better. Okay, so if it exists, we define this directional derivative, and we say that F is a CR mapping, or of class CR, if the iterated directional derivative, so you're taking all the directional derivatives up to order k, if they exist, so we can take in every directional derivative another direction if we want, and Then the additional requirement is that these derivatives should glue back together to give us continuous maps, right? When you think back what we did for curves, we not only wanted that the directional derivative for the derivative for the curve exists, but also all of these pointwise derivatives should glue back together to give us a continuous map. And this is what Bastiani calculus asks. So on one hand, you need to be able to compute these directional derivatives or ensure that they exist for some reason. And then if you set them together, so you combine them into a mapping which takes a base point from your open set U and then up to k directions if you have the kth derivative. So this should give you a continuous map from U times e to the k, the kth power of your space E with values in F. And for convenience, we define F naught. This is just the usual map, so when you haven't taken any derivative, and just to make sure that we're on the same page. So whenever I'm writing down a Cartesian product of topological spaces or topological vector spaces, the topology this Cartesian product gets, if nothing else is said, is the product topology. Right, so this since this is sometimes asked, so this is a product topology, and basically we Bastiani calculus asks that all directional derivatives exist and they glue back to give us a continuous mapping. So, and then again a little bit of lingo. So if F is a CK map for all natural numbers K, then we say F is smooth or C infinity. And just to take to fix some notation. So up here we have the df, and this is of course the same as the d1f. And for curves, we get we get back the usual derivative we have seen in the last two chapters. So the c dot of the two curves. Yes, the C dot of the two curves is then just the directional derivative of the curve in the direction of the one, right? So the curve, if you want to derivate that, there's only one direction, well, up to a sign perhaps in the real, and this is the one. Okay. So this is the definition in Bastiani calculus of when we call a mapping C1 or differentiable or CK or smooth. And on one hand, you already see that this definition is relatively simple, right? So directional derivatives are easy to compute if you want, or at least one can hope. If one can write down the mapping, then it's hopefully easy to compute these directional derivatives. And usually what you can do induction arguments to show that a mapping is not only C1, but CK or even smooth. So since we are building up the differentiability from the C1 concept and stack them recursively on top of each other, we get a nice concept of differentiability which can be checked, for example, using induction arguments. And we shall see some examples of this. But let's switch now over again to the writing here. Okay, and right. So let's do a short remark. On this. So what almost immediately follows from the definitions, and you can check the details as an exercise, is if you take the second derivative of the F at some point in directions v and w, this is the limit of t going to zero, d of the differential quotient. Now for the first derivative, x plus t w v minus df x v. Right, so the second derivative is just computed as the derivative of the first one. And some more notations which we will encounter frequently. If we want to compute the kth derivative of f at x in some directions v1 to vk, then this is the same. Yes, d dt t set to 0 of dk minus 1 f x plus t vk. And then we have to take here v1 to vk minus 1. Okay. And finally, f is ck if and only if f is ck minus 1 and the k minus first derivative of f is c1, then the kth derivative of f is just the derivative of the k minus first derivative of f. This is basically straightforward, so there's nothing, there's not much to prove. This mostly follows from the definitions if one writes them down. But let's have a look at an example of a Bastiani differentiable map. And basically, whenever you set up a differential calculus, there are several examples you absolutely, or some several mappings or classes of mappings you absolutely want to be differentiable. And one of these classes are continuous linear mappings. So this is, let's assume we have a continuous linear mapping A from, so between locally convex spaces. And well, then let's prove that A is C1. So let's compute the derivative of this one in some direction. So by definition, this is the limit as t goes to 0, t inverse multiplied with A of x plus tv minus A of x. Well, and so we just explored that A is linear, so and then that is continuous. So in other words, this is A of the limit, sorry, t going to 0 of A, sorry, not of A, A is already out there, a bit hasty here, of V. Because the t terms, the x term cancels and the t goes away with the t inverse. So this is just A of V. So we see that the derivative of our mapping is just the linear map applied to the direction of the differential. So, and this is continuous in the two inputs x and v. Well, I mean, x is not even present there, so that's no problem. And since A is a continuous linear map, it's also continuous in the v. Okay. What we can do now, of course, so we can, of course, compute now the second derivative of this one. And let's see how this goes. Well, after what we have just seen, this is d of d a x differentiated in the direction of v. And then I want to, sorry, shouldn't use this notation like this. Let's perhaps write it like this. So d dt t equal to 0 dA of x plus tw of v. However, what we see now is this is d dt t equal to 0 of A of v, so it doesn't depend on the parameter t at all, so we get 0 here. Well, hence A is C2, where the derivative just vanishes, the second one, and therefore is continuous. So it's a C2 map, and by trivial induction. A is a C infinity map. So this so continuous linear mappings are smooth. And you can indeed do a similar argument for every continuous K linear map, but then more derivatives will appear. Okay, so continuous linear mappings are Bastiani smooth. Usually I will just say smooth, since whenever I use the term smooth, I mean in the Bastiani sense. Okay. However, let's before we do any more examples, let's analyze the derivative a little bit. And how do we do this? Let's say f from U to F is a C1 map. And in this section, we will always have that the U is an open subset of some locally convex space. And F is, of course, also locally convex. Then the derivative at every point is homogeneous of degree 1. What do I mean by that? Basically, you can take out any scalar, so x, v are now in u times e, and s is a real number. So this is exactly what we expect from the derivative. Think back of what you want. I mean, if this was a finite dimensional derivative, then you'd expect to get some sort of matrix, and if you multiply a matrix with a vector, which is in turn multiplied by a number, then you can also take out the number from the multiplication right in front. So this is basically capturing what we know already from the finite dimensional setting, just in some new notation. So let's prove this. What happens if we derivate f in the direction of 0 times v? This is just the same as if we derivate it in the direction of the 0 vector. And what you can see directly from the definition of the differential quotient, this gives us 0, right? So, and this is, of course, the same times as 0 times df of x v. Okay, so without loss of generality, we can now assume that that s is not equal to 0, and consider df x s v. So by definition, this is the limit as t goes to 0, t inverse multiplied with f of x plus tsv minus f of x. Okay. And so we just do the following trick. Since s is not 0, we just insert it 2 times. So s times the limit of t goes to 0, s times t inverse, f of x plus t s v minus f of x. And then we see that just after relabeling this whole affair, this gets the same, so this is the same as the differential quotient. For df x v, or in other words, when we take the limit, we get s times df x v, and this proves the small lemma. So this is homogeneous in the second component. We can take out scalars there. And let's see some consequences. So our overall aim in this chapter is we have now these Bastiani smooth or Bastiani differentiable mappings. And basically this map, this chapter is like a review of finite dimensional calculus, but now for Bastiani smooth mappings, right? So we want to establish many of the basic tools from calculus. Unfortunately, this might be a little bit boring if your finite dimensional calculus is up to speed. But I just want to make the point here that all of this works also in this very abstract, locally convex vector space setting with the Bastiani calculus. And we will later on then use all of these tools or formulas for the derivatives and so forth in our approach to differential geometry. And one of the main goals of this section is to establish a chain rule for Bastiani calculus. In some older literature, you sometimes read the wrong proof that there's supposedly no chain rule for Bastiani calculus. This is wrong. I mean, what we really want to define later on manifolds using Bastiani calculus. And if there were no chain rule, then there we would have a big problem, because then there's no reasonable way of defining what we mean by a smooth map in Bastiani sense between infinite dimensional manifolds. So the main goal here is now to establish this this chain rule for the Bastiani calculus. However, we need a bit more machinery to do this. And let's define some things. So, or prove something. So let's prove a mean value theorem. And so the mean value theorem is as follows. So we have E and F locally convex spaces. And F from U to F, C1 map, where of course U is again open in E. Then the statement is, if I want to compute the difference between two mappings, the difference between two function values in there, then this I can do this as a weak integral over the derivative of x plus t y minus x, derivative in the direction of y minus x dt, for, and this works for all x, y in U, such that the segment, so basically I want to take the line segment, so exactly the wrong way around, I want that the line segment between x and y such that t is 0, 1, the convex combinations of x and y, that this line segment, this should lie completely in U. So we need to require this to make sense of this this whole formula, since we have only defined the f on U. And so we need to assure that we can actually evaluate f and or its derivative on this line segment. Okay, and how do we prove this? Well, we basically want to go back to this fundamental theorem we have for curves. So we go, we define a curve now from 0, 1 with values in F, the second vector space. And how do we do it? We just take F of x plus t times y minus x. Right. So this is C1 curve, just by definition, because the F is a Bastiani C1 with derivative. So let's compute the derivative of this one. This is limit as S tends to zero of S inverse gamma of T plus S minus gamma of T, or in other words, this is the limit as S tends to zero of S inverse was let's write this
f of x plus t plus s y minus x minus f of x plus t y minus x. But by s. And so if we just go through this, then we see that this is given by the derivative of f at x plus t times y minus x in the direction of y minus x. Okay. In particular, gamma prime is continuous as df is. And so we see that this is a C1 curve. And if we apply now the fundamental theorem, for curves. So this was 116, right? So we saw this a little bit earlier. To the derivative of gamma, we obtain the formula for f, right? So then which formula do I mean? I mean this integral formula we have here. Right. This is just because we could produce a curve from our differentiable mapping. And now we finally come to what I already said about this, about the locally or the calculus in locally convex spaces. So if f from u to f is C1 with df equal to zero, and U is a connected set, then F is constant, right? So vanishing of the derivative on locally convex spaces gives us that the mapping itself needs to be constant. So this works exactly as in finite dimensional calculus. And let's do the proof, because this enlightens also why we need a locally convex space here. So if x is in U, choose a convex neighborhood. Where x is contained in the v and v sits inside of the u, right? And since the space is locally convex, u is open, we've seen earlier that there is some convex neighborhood. So for example, one of these semi-norm balls which fits around the x and sits inside of the u. Okay, so if y is now something in v, then we can apply the formula from 1 to 5, and this just tells us if f of x minus f of y, this is then the integral from 0 to 1 df of something. So I'm not bothering now with writing out what the something is, because what I know, since we assumed that the derivative vanishes identically, so this is zero. And if I integrate something which is constantly zero, I always get zero. So therefore, f of x is the same as f of y. And this is now just the locally convex guise of this classical proof from multidimensional analysis, if you want, where you use the convexity of say, for example, norm balls to establish the mapping needs to be constant, and by connectedness. Of u usual open closed argument shows that f of x is equal to f of y for all y in U.
If you don't know what I mean by this usual open closed argument, then we'll just return to this in the exercise sessions, right? So this is one standard argument of how you argue with connected subsets. So I'm not going into the details here. Okay. However, this finishes the proof. If you don't know what I mean by open closed, then we'll discuss it later. Anyway, let's go to the proposition, which is a bit tedious to prove because it's a bit technical, but this will help us a lot later on when we want to derivate more mappings which are defined on more complicated domains. And this is the so-called rule on partial derivatives. And what we do is we let E, F, and H, now three spaces, be locally convex. And U now be an open set in the Cartesian product of E and F. And we consider a mapping on this open subset, which takes values in the third space, H. This should be a continuous mapping. Okay. And the statement is then that F is C1 if and only if the following holds, the limits D1 F X Y in the direction of V1. This is defined as the limit as t goes to 0 of f of x plus t of V1 y minus f of x y. And, well, this is the partial derivative with respect to the first component. So we are only derivating with respect to the first component. The second one is constant. And of course, we can also write this down or a similar formula for the partial derivative with respect to the second component. Again, we define it as the limit. Now the first component is constant. And we derivate in the second component. So if and only if these limits exist, for all x and y in U, and V1, V2 in E times F, and extend to continuous mappings di f from u times ei. Oh, sorry. Shouldn't have called them. Should, to be consistent with my notation, I should call the locally convex spaces e1 and e2. And it's easier to write all these things down. So E1 and E2. Right, so we have this for I1, 2. Okay, in this case, what we get is DF XY. So V1, V2, if we take the derivative of the full map, not just a partial derivative, then we get that this is equal to the sum of the first partial derivative plus the second partial derivative. Okay. So we get this little formula here, which in the script is formula 1.2. Okay, so what this means is if we have a mapping which is defined on a product, we can then we can then compute the partial derivatives, which is often much easier than to see what the actual derivative would be. So this will this will ease computations of derivatives on of mappings on products. However, as you see, we had to define a lot of stuff here, and so the proof is a little bit technical. But bear with me for a little while. So let's give a proof of this statement, which is more or less straightforward. But okay, so the easy direction is if f is C1. Then the di of f exists and are continuous, right? So for example, if you look at the d1 here, why do these does this derivative exist? You can just write this as df of x, y, and then derivate it in the direction of v1. And obviously, if we want to take the full differential, we have to take also something here in the second component, but there we just take zero. So we get this formula for the first partial derivative, and obviously you can also do it for the second partial derivative. So these partial derivatives can be expressed as something of the full derivative. Okay. Conversely, let us assume that DIF exists and is continuous. Okay, and let's fix x, y in u and v1, v2 in e1 times e2. And let's fix an epsilon greater than zero such that x, y plus t v1, v2 is in U for all T whose absolute value is smaller than epsilon, right? So I just want to make sure that everything makes sense here. Okay. Right. So let's do now the following calculation. So we want now to investigate the differential quotient of the full map, and want to see that this limit, I mean, when we take the limit t going to zero, exists. Okay, and the usual trick, as always, when one considers such a thing, and we know that the partials exist, is to do the insertion of a clever zero. So we have x plus t v1 y plus t v2 minus f of x plus t v1 y plus f of x plus t v1 y minus f of x y. Okay, and right, so let's introduce some brackets here. What we see, the latter part, we can already identify this with a partial derivative. However, the first part is perhaps not so clear. I mean, the first item we have here. However, we can apply proposition 1, 2, 5. So this was the one with rewriting a difference of two things using a using an integral, and we see that this is from 0 to 1 d2 f of x plus t v1 y plus t plus t times s plus v2, and then derivate it in the direction v2 ds. And we can also do the same trick if we want with the with the second term, d1 of f, x plus stv1, y in the direction of v1 ds. Okay. Okay, and let's give this thing here a name. So let's call this 1, 3. Okay, and note that the integrals in 1, 3 make sense for t equal to 0, whereas the term we started with, so we have no idea whether this makes sense. However, the integrals make sense for t equal to 0, and we shall cheat at this small instance. So the cheat here is what we are not going to prove, because on one hand it's technical and we don't want to get bogged down with these details. One can prove that the weak integrals depend continuously on the parameter t. Thus, we can compute the limit of 1, 3 by taking it inside of the integral. And usually this has to be justified, right? So we are not, in this lecture, we are not going there. So we're not doing the step. It's not that hard. The usual proof, whatever that means, works for these weak integrals. And if you look into the lecture notes, there is, there you will find a reference to where you can find such or a proof for this fact that you can take in the limit into the integral, that you really have continuous parameter dependence. It's a little bit like in the previous part where I said we are not going to prove the second part of the fundamental theorem because you need a little bit more knowledge about the weak integrals. This is exactly the same here. So you need a little bit more on basically you need to prove an integral estimate for these weak integrals with respect to some semi-norms to make it work. However, there are nice books which are explaining all of this. Since we want to go beyond just calculus on locally convex spaces, we are not doing these details here, so we are skipping it, and that's what I'm cheating here. So we can thus take the limit of the left-hand side of this 1.3 and see that it exists. Or in other words, this df exists. So this was one of the things which we had to prove, and now moreover, taking
the limit into the integral. Proposition 1, 2, 5 shows that the right hand side of 1.3 becomes d1 of f x y in direction of v1 plus d2 f x y in direction of v2. And so we know that this will then equal dfxy in direction v1 and v2. Yeah, so this is the formula 1, 2 holds. Now, this was the last item which we claimed in the statement of the theorem. Okay. So there are a few details I'm hiding here to get somewhere. And there is another detail which I will be hiding now. And this is the following. This is the following characterization of Bastiani smooth mappings. So I'll just show it to you because we will need it for two things. We will show that the derivative is linear in the second argument. So far, we only know that it's homogeneous, so we can take out scalars from the second argument. And we will use it in the proof of the chain rule. The proof for this next characterization is not that hard. Unfortunately, it's super technical, right? So this proposition, which goes back, I guess, to a large paper by Bertram Glöckner and Neb, is so a mapping is of class C1 if and only if there exists a continuous mapping on this enlarged space. So you take all the triples X, V, S. So again, you should think of X as the base point where you want to take the derivative. V is the direction in which you want to take the derivative. And S is now a real parameter. So you have this mapping, this set, which is called U square brackets 1. And this should look a little bit strange. However, what this collects are all the triplets X, V, S, such that X plus S times V is still contained in U, right? So in principle, those triplets here, X, S, and V, those are all the numbers and vectors which are occurring if you compute the derivative. If you compute the derivative, so in the differential quotient, we usually want to define the mapping F on exactly these sums here, X plus S times V. And okay, so we are not only asking, this U square brackets 1 collects all of these triplets such that it makes sense to evaluate F in here. However, we ask that there exists a continuous mapping such that if we evaluate F in X plus SV and subtract F of X, then we get T times this mapping F square brackets 1. And you see immediately if you take the T here on the right-hand side and just put it on to the left-hand side by taking T inverse, then so on the left, yes?
So this should be S then.
Crap, yes, yeah. Exactly. Yeah, okay, sorry. Yes, exactly. Unfortunately, here on this slide, T equals S. Yes, exactly. So all of the Ts are equal to the S. Exactly. Exactly. So you want that this mapping F square brackets is basically giving you the differential quotient. And this is also how you define F square brackets if the T is non-zero. So, I mean, for T non-zero or here for S non-zero,
The f square brackets is just the differential quotient. So this makes this is no problem. The question is, of course, how do you define it for t equal to zero? Well, if f is differentiable for t equal to zero, then you just take the derivative with the correct values. So this is already half of the proposition of how you prove that if is of class C1, how do you get this mapping f square bracket 1? You just say outside of 0, it's just a differential quotient. If it's 0, then you take the derivative. And however, you can prove that if whenever such a continuous mapping exists, then you can reconstruct the derivative from the values of this mapping f square brackets 1 at t or s equal to 0. The idea of this whole, I mean, this looks now like a super technical way of describing derivatives, and to a certain extent it is. If you read sort of the original paper of how you set this up, the idea of this mapping f square brackets 1 is you shouldn't separate the limit or the derivative in this case from the points from which you used to compute the limit. Okay, so we have this proposition. This is an equivalent characterization of Bastiani differentiable on these mappings. And we will only encounter it, I mean, this description of Bastiani differentiability in the next two propositions, which... So we're using this f square bracket thing to prove on one hand that the derivative is linear in the second argument, and to prove the chain rule. Because if you have this characterization of differentiability, then both of these things are relatively easy. So a lot of the technicalities are hidden in proving this characterization with the f square bracket. Okay, so let's go back now to what we want to do. Okay, so basically what I want to prove is first the lemma, and then the chain rule. So if from an open subset U with values f is C1, then df x. So if we freeze the point at which we take the derivative, then we get a mapping which takes directions and sends them to the directional derivative. So then this is a continuous linear map for each x in U. And since I assume that everybody's familiar with finite dimensional calculus, what this just tells you is if my spaces are finite dimensional, then this df x and then a blank is just is something like the Jacobi matrix of the function f, right? So so this lemma is basically telling us what we already know in finite dimensions holds to a certain extent also in Bastiani calculus. So we get pointwise, we get continuous linear mappings as derivatives. Okay, so let's prove this. Okay, so let's fix x in U, then df x dot is continuous as a partial map of df, right? So since f is C1, we know that the mapping df is continuous. By lemma 1, 2, 4, we know already that dfx sv is the same as s times dfxv. So we have already the linearity here. The homogeneity for all scalars when it suffices to prove additivity. Okay, and now let's prove that it's additive. So let's take V and W from E, and let's look at the differential quotient. So T inverse of F of X plus T V plus W and minus F of X. Okay. And okay, again, insertion of arguments. So this is T inverse F of X plus T V plus W minus F of X plus T V, and then plus F of X plus T V minus F of X. I mean, all of these arguments basically work in the same way. However, we now have our characterization of of the Bastiani differentiability. So first, we just rewrite this this way. So we put a bracket here. And now recall what we have seen in this definition of the map with the square brackets. So we see basically, since t is not equal to zero, you see that the first term is f square bracket 1 of x plus tv w t in this notation. And the second term is f 1 of x v t. Okay, again, the right hand side makes sense for t equal to zero whence we can pass to the limit and see that, well, on the left hand side, what we just get is df of x in the direction of v plus w. On the left hand side, so what's happening if you pass to the limit in the first term? Well, we have to set, so we get f of square, f square bracket 1, x, v at 0, and plus f square bracket 1, x, v, 0. And now we have to again translate what we have here in the square brackets. What this means is if we have the f square bracket at zero, and we know that the f is differentiable, this just means that this is the same as dfx w plus dfx v. So this is exactly the additivity we were looking for. When you ask now, do you really need the f square bracket 1 to do this? I mean, this trick we had here was now more or less window dressing, right? So it just enabled us to wave a little bit our hands and get rid of the limits on the right hand side. You can of course also deduce this by going just through the limits. The only thing which we saved by applying this characterization is we save a little bit of arguing about why the limits on the right hand side are exactly what I claim that they are, right?
Sorry. Oh. Yes, so yes. Why couldn't you just use the mean value theorem?
That's also possible. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, this would be the other way of doing it. For the next proposition, I mean, as always, there are several ways of proving this lemma. Especially this one. For the chain rule, basically this F1 square bracket introduced to conveniently prove the chain rule, which will be our next proposition. The reason why I chose to do this lemma using the F square bracket 1 is to get a little bit more acquaintance with what this notation means and how you can go back and forth between the derivative and the square bracket mapping. So this is the only reason why we do this proof here with the F square bracket 1, right? I mean, in principle, if you like, you can also deduce the chain rule using the mean value theorem, but this gets a lot more messy. Okay, let's have a look at this. For us, the chain rule is really the most important one. Proposition chain rule. Okay, so the usual setup. Let F from an open subset of a locally convex space, go to another locally convex space, G be defined on an open subset of this other locally convex space. Let's say we go to H, and these mappings should be C1 maps, such that F of U gets mapped inside of V. Then the composition of those two things is a C1 map with derivative given by what you would expect. So D of G composed with F at some point X derivative in the direction V is the same as dg of f of x in the direction of df x derivative in the direction of v. Or perhaps in more familiar notation, g composed with f prime of x, when I'm not giving a direction but just sort of speak abstractly about these differentials, then this is the linear map which you get by taking the G here and taking the derivative at point F of X and then compose it with the derivative of F. And then I have to insert, as the above shows, the vector V, so the direction. So the second formula here is more on the level of linear mappings, whereas let's say the first formula is perhaps a little bit more exact what you actually mean by this G primes and so forth. Okay, so let's prove this chain rule. Use notation from lemma 1 to 8. And let's say we have x, y, and t in u square brackets 1. So recall that this just means that x plus t times y is still in u. And let's say we have t is not equal to 0. Okay, and then we look at the quotient. This is more or less now, again, the classical proof of the chain rule. As a lot of these things we are doing here are more or less the classical proofs, just adapted to the locally convex setting. I mean, I apologize a little bit because there's not much more exciting going on here. But at least it turns out that for Bastiani calculus, a lot of the stuff which is going on, you can just give proofs which are similar to the finite, or if you want, at least one dimension, even one dimensional case. Okay, so let's just rewrite the argument of the G. Again, this is the classical chain rule proof, if you want. So I write it as T times F of X plus T times Y minus F of X, and I divide by T, minus G F of X. And so in other words, I can rewrite this as G 1 F of X. Sorry, there are no semicolons here. G 1 F of X. And then the second one would be F 1 of X, Y, T. And then we have a T again here. Okay. Right. And apparently, yes, let's give this a number 1.4. Again, Thurstein, coming to your comment, you could of course also do this again with the with the fundamental theorem. The main reason what was hidden in 1.2.8, or what is hidden with these F1s, is again the convergence argument. Why this is taken care of without us having to worry about this. Whether we can take limits of all these things, right? So this is what is the added value of the 1.28. So what I can do now is I can define a function u from u1 with values in h, and I can say where h of x, y, t is defined as exactly what I have up here, g1 of f of x. F1 x y t, and then the t. So we exactly on the nose have this one, right? And so this extends 1.4 for t equal to 0. So this makes sense, just because the one for g1 and f1 makes sense. And what this shows is that G, or if I take the derivative of this one, X, Y, then this is the same as G composed with F1, X, Y, 0. And this is the same as H of X, Y, 0, or in other words, this is just g1 of f of x, f1 x, y, 0, and 0. So we know what this is. This is df of x in the direction of y. And this shows that we get as a formula dg of at the point f of x, then derivated in the direction df of x in the direction of y. Okay. This shows two things. On one hand, we get the formula, and note that dg composed with f exists and is continuous. Right? So G composed with F is C1, which you also wanted to know. I mean, basically, it's just a little bit more fancy notation for the classical proof from one-dimensional calculus even. The question is only whether these limits exist, Right, and so we had our nice little technical lemma where we are hiding these questions. But in principle, this is just the standard chain rule you get. Okay, now let's see. So we have two more technical results which we will be using later when we are working on manifolds, and so unfortunately we need to prove or at least motivate them. So let me at least state the following lemma. So let E and Fi and some index set be locally convex spaces. And F a mapping from E going into the direct product of these spaces. Sorry, shouldn't have taken again. We obviously you don't want only to do it on all of E. We want to take an open subset U of E on which this one is defined. So then let's assume that K is a natural number or zero, and set Fi to be equal to Bri composed with F, where Pri is the projection on the ith component. Probably I should have. Okay, let's make this J to make it unambiguous what I mean by NJ. So this is the canonical projection. Okay. Right, so we have this canonical projection here. And the statement is then F is CK if and only if every Fi is CK and the following formula holds. I will only state it for the first derivative. So df of x in the direction of v. This is then given by the family dfi of x also in the direction of v. So for I, and x should be in u and v in E. And since we know that we can iteratively compute higher derivatives, then this shows also that a similar formula is true for the higher derivatives. I mean, this should come as no surprise, right? So from finite dimensional calculus, whenever we have a mapping into a product, say, for example, in R to the dth power, then we can check the component functions for differentiability, and this should give us the notion of differentiability. Okay, for completeness sake, let's prove this. So if F is CK, then Fi is, so this composition is CK as a composition of a CK map with a continuous linear map. So this is the PRI. And we have seen that continuous linear maps are smooth. So this establishes one direction. And note that what happened, how do we compute the differential? So we have already seen once, if we derivate a continuous linear mapping, then we get composed with something, then we get basically the same continuous linear mapping composed with the derivative of the mapping we had. So we had this formula for curves. It also holds for more general mappings. This is an exercise. So we can actually compute the derivative of the fi in terms of the, just projecting down the derivative. And again, this is exactly as you know from finite dimensions. So this establishes the formula for the derivative. Assume now that conversely, every fi is a CK map. Okay. Let us argue by induction on K in the natural numbers. Okay. So recall that we call a mapping C infinity or smooth if it's CK for every natural number K. So really the smooth case is just a consequence. If we get it for every finite order of differentiability, then we will also get it for the smooth case. Okay. Okay, so let's do two cases first. So the case K equal to zero. So F is continuous if and only if fi is continuous for every I in I. And the reason for this is that the product topology on this product is initial with respect to these projection mappings, PRI. So you really get an equivalence on the at least when it comes to the continuity. However, obviously the more interesting case is now what happens with the derivatives. So let's do the case K is equal to one. Well, okay, also this is relatively easy to do. However, let's write down the differential quotient. And now we know that this is T inverse of the family Fi x plus Tv minus Fi x. So we are just writing the product component wise. And since the scalar multiplication on this product is also component wise, we can just take the product inside. And taking the limit we get df x of v on the left hand side, and on the right hand side, since we know every component here, we this will converge to dfi for t going to zero. So this is really dfi x v I and I giving again 1.6. Not 1.6. We give this a name. Okay, in the script it's 1.6. So this is the formula again for the derivative, and showing that that df exists and is continuous by the case k equal to zero. Therefore, therefore the f is C1. Okay.
So the induction step is now trivial since we know that d of dk minus 1 of f is the same as dk of f. So we can argue as in k equal to 1 only for dk minus 1 of f. This establishes, I mean, there's not much happening here actually. Right, so these are sort of the technical details of why this works, and in principle, you have probably seen these kinds of proofs for finite dimensional space, and it's perhaps nice to see that they also hold for infinite dimensional space in this Bastiani setting. Okay, and now the final thing I want to do in this chapter, before we in the afternoon talk about manifolds things which are more in the direction of what you actually want to be doing in differential geometry, let me establish another lemma, which will look a bit strange. I will state the lemma and then we'll explain one of the concepts which is appearing here. So let F again be defined on an open subset of E, be a C1, sorry, I want C0 be continuous. And again, of course, E and F are locally convex spaces. So assume that F naught in F is sequentially closed subspace. So this should be a vector subspace such that F of U, or the image of F, is completely contained in the subspace. And let's say we have k some index, or perhaps even infinity. So the lemma says then f is ck if and only if the co-restriction. So what do I mean by this? So this is the mapping going from u into f naught. Is ck. Okay, before we prove this, I need to explain two things, which you might know or might not know. So let's see. Let's remark two things. If f is locally convex, then every subspace of f inherits a locally convex space structure from f. Right, so in this sense, this F naught, this is, I just wrote sequentially closed vector subspace, but what this means is, or what the meaning of the second equation here, or of this formula here is, so you want to the co-restriction now deals with this mapping F as a mapping into the new locally convex space F naught. Right. So, but of course, how do you induce a locally convex structure on a subspace? You just take the subspace topology, and then it should be easy to see that, say, for example, semi-norms and so forth restrict to the subspace and give you again a locally convex vector topology on the subspace. So this is the first remark, and then the second remark is a subset let's say A in F is sequentially closed. If every Cauchy sequence in A converges. Sorry, not Cauchy sequence. I don't know anything about completeness. If every convergent sequence in A takes its limit in A. Yeah, so the reason why I couldn't write Cauchy sequence, I haven't said anything about the completeness of the locally convex space. So actually, if I don't require that the locally convex space F is complete, then I don't know whether the Cauchy sequences will actually converge in this. However, what I want is that if a sequence converges, if a sequence converges in the set, it's a convergent sequence such that every element in the sequence lies in the subset A, then also the limit should automatically be in A. That's sequentially closed. And this statement here with the sequentially closed, when you've seen similar statements in finite dimensions. So every finite dimensional subspace of a finite dimensional space is automatically closed with respect to the usual topology, say, of Euclidean space. So you automatically get that stuff is sequentially closed and even stronger properties. However, for these locally convex spaces, this is not automatic. So if I choose a horrible subspace, a horrible linear subspace of my infinite dimensional locally convex space, I might very well get a set which is not sequentially closed. So I might have sequences which live completely inside of this vector subspace, but converge outside of the vector subspace. And this is something which is new in infinite dimensions. You cannot have this in finite dimensions because they're automatically all vector subspaces are sequentially closed. Okay, let's do the proof and then have a break. So if F restricted to F naught is CK, so is the mapping F, because I can just write it as iota composed with F co-restricted to F naught, where the iota is just the vector space inclusion. So I send F naught into F by taking an element x equal to x, and this is continuous linear. Right, and then we have again the composition of a continuous linear mapping, i.e. a smooth mapping with a CK mapping, and by the chain rule, the result is then again a CK mapping. Okay, so this is a consequence of the chain rule. So conversely, let us assume that F is, let's start easier with the C1 map again. And X should be in U, V should be in E, and we pick a sequence Tn converging to zero in the reals such that X plus TNV is in U for all N. And then by definition, DFX V is can be defined as a limit as N tends to infinity, TN inverse F of X plus TNV minus F of X. Well, and now let's see what happens. So this guy lives inside F naught by definition, by our assumption on F. this guy lives inside of F naught. Since it's a vector subspace, then also the difference and the scalar multiple lies in the vector subspace. So we see that all of this is inside of our vector subspace. And since the vector subspace is sequentially closed, also the limit lies in F naught. And what we see here, thus the df of xv is inside of the F naught. Okay, but then, I mean, what does that mean? We can define df co-restricted to the F naught as a mapping u times e with values in F naught, just as sending x and v to df x v. Right, so we can just take the derivative of the large map, and so we see that it satisfies the defining property. So exists. So this means the co-restriction derivative exists and is continuous when it's, f is c1 for higher k. We can repeat the trick. For for d k inverse of f restricted to f naught. In conclusion, f restricted to f naught is ck if f is ck, and this proves the theorem. So, I mean, this looks a little bit strange with the sequentially closed things, but in the end, this will allow us to make sense of the differentiability of mappings which take values in a submanifold. This is sort of the reason why we are interested in this lemma, which shows that instead of testing always with the whole space, we can also test with the subspace. Okay. So this is it for the first chapter on Bastian.